Welcome back, everyone. We are kicking off the finale adventure for the Invasion Patreon campaign. So we're going to be getting into that, which was a fun one. It's a bit of a little bit of narcissism show. It's been 2 or 3 months since I wrote this one. I was going back and reading something. I like the way I did that. So this will be hopefully a fun one for the players too, as we kick this one off. We're going to do a little bit of a recap before we start, but one thing to shout out, especially if you're a Dungeon Jedi Master Patreon, go download this adventure. There's 5 different ones of them. The only one that there's a few things I've added in for this group, but the only adventure that was straight up added in was the recent one on Merc with the Crusaders. All the other ones you can go through and download them for your Patreon and play with your crew. So have some fun with that. And then check us out this Thursday. It's not going to be on my Twitch. It's going to be on my YouTube channel. We are running our Game of the Month, Call of Cthulhu. I'm pretty stoked with this one. April's my birthday month, so I actually want to play the game I've wanted to play for years, and we actually brought in an outside GM to help run it for us. So looking forward to that, and as always, we'll be giving away a free PDF copy of the system, too. So come through for that. But I'm actually going to do a little bit of a longer recap just to sum up everything that got us here. So we've had five PCs were all brought from various factions of the galaxy that had been at war with itself for decades, with the Sith Dominion waging war against the Galactic Republic to see who could reign over all and control the galaxy. With that, there have been numerous kind of core factions at the heart of this conflict. Of course, you've got the Republic, with the led by the Galactic Senate and Supreme Chancellor Ovano. Within them, for the longest time, you had the Jedi helping to spear the Republic effort. But as Chancellor Ovano rose, the Jedi star has fallen a little bit, with some of them pulling away from the Republic's military arms and kind of sequestering themselves a bit away from the conflict. Within that as well, you've got the Sith Dominion, led by Darth Dominus, made up of a pretty radical military force who initially started with liberating the Outer Rim and has gradually been expanding and taking over bits of the Republic's midsection and trying to get towards its core. Dominus and the Dominion are pretty merciless in their approach, but some say they've done some good for the galaxy, with the Dominion being completely anti-slavery, removing that from the Outer Rim, and actually giving a decent standard of living for its citizens, even the poor ones in the Rim, at the expense of any freedom you had. So, age-old fight, would you rather be free or would you rather have what you want? But with that, you've got the Mandalorians as well, who used to be a part of the Dominion, but broke off after Mandalore the planet was taken over by Mandalore the Exalted, the person, because they like to name everything the same thing. But with the Mandalorians becoming a new faction in the war, steadily carving out territory amongst them, their quadrant of the space, initially stealing a lot of Dominion's tech, but now trying to get their own manufacturing going and stealing everybody else's tech while that gets up and running. We also have Zerka, another one of the big factions in here. They do control their own little section of space, but are primarily looking to sell, buy, and just pretty much increase their market share whatever they're doing. They're a credits-driven organization that's usually at the cutting edge of research, but at the back edge of morals. And our groups, kind of outside of the Dominion, they all had a player from each of these factions, the Mandalorians, Zerka, the Republic, and all found themselves on the planet Vela, which is being fought over by both the Dominion and the Republic due to its vast amount of war-forged resources. So the Viridium to build bombs, the Banagas for blasters, just a very nutrient-rich planet, and had both the Dominion and Republic having large fleets stationed above as they fought for control. The group found that the new force, the Yuuzhan Vong, have invaded the galaxy and set up shop on Vela, using the kind of the Republic and Dominion's war as a bit of a backdrop on this planet to be able to insert themselves, study their hostile enemies, and then began setting a plan in motion to destroy the planet. The group was able to free Lord Galvin, a Sith Dominion officer who had been trapped on the planet, as well as kill the officer of the Yuuzhan Vong, who had been stationed on the planet and were overseeing the efforts. But unfortunately, the damage to the planet was too much, and Vela was destroyed after the group escaped, saving one of their two of their longtime allies, General Vett and Master Kalu, who had been overseeing the Vela operations. With that, we did a pretty heavy blow to both the Dominion and the Republic, with one of their, with both of the nation's larger fleets lost in the conflict. But the group was able to escape and report back to the Republic, later learning that the colony named Saiho had gone dark and had been lost communication. With that, the group was able to look into that colony and find that the Yuuzhan Vong had taken it over and were using it as a bit of a grow house slash training ground. They found that the warriors they fought there initially were just formidable as the one they came across on Vela. And it seemed like the Yuuzhan Vong were using the small colony as a little bit of place to bloody some of their troops who hadn't really seen true combat. The group was able to then escape with the remainder of the colony of Saiho, helping to liberate them from the trap that had become the planet. Finally, after that, the group was called to testify before the Galactic Senate. Before doing that, they stopped into Varz's Mandalorian contacts, let him know about a ship they had captured leaving Crusader space, filled with kind of crewed by some Wookiees and Crusaders, but most of the thing that caught their eye was that the cargo hold was filled with Wookiees who've been implanted with a living slave control device called a York Coral. We're looking into that. The group found a way to, with Talos spearheading the effort to remove the implant and keep the patient safe, and decided to investigate and figure out what was going on in Kashyyyk. Later finding that the Crusaders, or at least some of the Crusaders, were working with the Master Shaper called Nim Yin to provide them with both outlaws or people who had violated the Crusaders' laws or will on planet as slaves and test subjects, as well as different creatures for them to shape and experiment on, with the group nearly dying to the shaped Y-Shock. I think it was like 3 or 4 HP away from a TPK, but they came through and then were able to escape Kashyyyk after burning one of the Y-Shock tree branches on their way, or the Worshik tree branches on the way out. Afterwards, the group testified in front of the Senate, kind of bringing the galaxy to in the know of what this true threat is and kind of everything that had been going along with the invaders and trying to steer them away from the kind of conflict with Dominion to focus on kind of who could do the galaxy the most harm. And eventually finding that one of the senators of the Galactic Senate had actually been, was either all along a Yuuzhan Vong plant or had been replaced by a Yuuzhan Vong, and were able to catch him in the act and reveal to the galaxy that they've been infiltrated at the highest level, earning, allowing Supreme Chancellor Ovano to commission a fleet that the crew will be advising, kind of brought in as consultants for, that's going to search the Outer Rim for trails of these Yuuzhan Vong infiltrators and see if they can find their fleet and army, and hopefully bring a win in for the Republic and the galaxy. Sweet. So that's where we'll pick up. Before we dive in, does anybody have any questions? I know there's a lot of things going over, but been a little bit of campaign.
We had bought basic supplies and stuff if we needed them, right?
You did, and the Republic gave you a little bit of supplies too.
Yeah. Because I had something I wanted to purchase.
Oh, definitely. What are you picking up?
Well, Uli's kind of noticed that sometimes Caesar just kind of doesn't have much to do or could use a little variety in what he can do, I should say. And so he would have gone out and bought a bandolier and just kind of kitted it out a little bit with a incendiary grenade, frag grenade, cryo grenade, a plasma grenade, and a stun grenade. And he was going to present that to Caesar.
Caesar would look at this and give a smile. What a wonderful gift. And I had not to give you anything. Thank you.
Well, don't worry about it. Here, with Dash, you know, on his special assignment, figured we could use a little bit of Dash, if you know what I mean? And who better than you to bring him with us, you know?
I wouldn't be able to do him justice, but I think he would approve.
I think if you kill just one of those guys with one of these grenades, he'd be super happy.
Absolutely.
But hopefully that's Thank not you. Necessary. Although, what hasn't been necessary these last couple weeks?
Bee stalks.
Fair. Yeah. Perfectly. You guys are able to stock up on supplies. The Republic, I should have mentioned that in the recap. Your deal with Chancellor Oveno was able to kit out the Novacana, increasing the AI level for the ship, just at the expense of giving him the meager deal of the data that you had acquired for Operation Saberbreaker.
Paying out of pocket. And
Pam. Oh, that was the other thing too. I was going to contribute to that. Because how much was it? Like 8,000?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was going to put 3,000 towards that. I have plenty to spare.
Okay. I'll give myself
3,000. Add 3,000 credits to your. I work for Zirka too. I got to technically pay some.
Gosh.
Appreciate that. On top of the new kit for J1 on the Novacana, would it be possible to get? Hold on. I didn't want to guess on how many we need. I think we need 3 missiles. Yeah, no, 2 missiles. We have 2 Silent Thunder missiles left. And I got a little bit smart on ships recently. I think they all have to be of the same type. So would we be able to get 2 more Silent Thunder missiles as well?
I guess I'm gonna buy some, yeah.
They're so expensive.
How expensive much are we talking?
Let me look that up real quick.
I know it gets close to 1,000 for a missile. Like it's
hey, don't worry. I'm gonna be doing the same thing to my guys, so that's fine. Let's see. Silent Thunder missile. Oh, God. 1,500 each. Well, there goes my 3,000 credits.
I'll buy one.
Okay. There goes 1,500. So we have 4 Silent Thunder missiles now. Cool. That's updated. Good to go.
If it does make you feel better, the Republic did spend 297,000 equipping the ship to Tier 3.
Okay.
Bit of a consolation.
When you put it that way. I still want to get paid by Zirka, though. Back pay coming. Their ship, for Christ's sake.
You guys are getting paid for this?
No, that's what I've been complaining about this whole time. How long would you say we've actually been on this, Tegan, like from in game?
Well, I'm just going to do overall. I can't remember for Uli. Yeah. But it's been about 4 months as a whole.
Okay. Uli probably came in like halfway through.
Yeah.
I don't think Geert didn't last that
long. Yeah. Talos was being paid in coffee, sunflower seeds, and isolation. You all ruined that for him. So thank you.
Do him a part.
Perfect. Well, you guys, eventually the day comes. You are brought out to just one of the few areas of Coruscant by the Galactic Senate where you've got a little bit of clear sky. You can look above. Do you see the Republic fleet mustering for the Supreme Chancellor's approval? You see Republic starfighters kind of whipping in and out of over the skies, kind of some trailing the kind of the blue of the the Galactic Republic behind them, really stoking up the theatrics. You hear loud music playing in the background. It looks like they've got a live band and they are piping it through. You could tell they are putting a lot of like pageantry into this. Definitely trying to make a deal, big deal out of this. You see Republic soldiers kind of marching in lockstep towards their carriers to take off into the sky. And they actually invite you all to a podium next to the Supreme Chancellor, Oveno, your new friend. Actually, I forgot to mention this to recap with you, Caesar. Campaigned for to receive emergency powers, and he did receive emergency powers with Oveno having a little bit of an anti-force user streak. But yeah, he's been received supreme powers up for the Republic. And even despite his anti-force user streak, he does have a lot of support in the military itself. He's one of the credited forces behind the kind of turning around the war with Dominion and starting to push them back a little bit versus just Republic losing ground. You see he's in rare form today. He is speaking to the crowd. And he's kind of like definitely kind of just, you see passion and from like just a real kind of warrior streak behind his words. And he goes, "Fellow citizens of the Galactic Republic, today is the first day that we are going to push back against these new foes who have thought to take on the sterling child of the Republic. We are the galaxy's pinnacle nation, and we will fight for our people. We will fight for our borders, and any, whether they be the Dominion, the Mandalorians, the Hutts, any who think they can push back at us, will be thrown back. We will show these Yuuzhan Vong why we are the oldest nation in the galaxy and with the best people and the strongest military. Today is the day. Today we push them back." You see, kind of, he stops for applause. And you see a lot of the crowd kind of whips into it. And he actually kind of waves you all forward as well. And he'll go, "May have seen some of the testimony from these individuals, and while we may not always agree, and while I think their methods, well, they have their own methods, we'll say, but these men have been at the forefront of stopping these invaders, and we have tasked them with, regardless of their morals, to help us in the fight against the Yuuzhan Vong, and they will be consulting our forces." He kind of waves to the party. Address to a crowd. Let them know what glory awaits you. And you guys,
we'll just kind of shuffle there. Like, you really don't want me to talk, do we? Caesar?
No, Caesar's like, gesturing for the party to go first.
The two social. The two non-social butterflies from Zirka, Caesar not wanting to talk, and the Mandalorian. This is gonna go well.
Oh, wow, Caesar! Caesar, the charismatic one.
He's letting you guys talk first, though.
Bars.
We're gonna kill a lot of Vong.
You see, like Avena waits for a moment, like for beat. Like that is right. I may not always agree with the Mandalorians, but when we have one on our side, they will know why they've been a scourge of the galaxy.
Really? Yeah. Scourge? Really?
If Talos and Ulu do not step forward, then Caesar will, and he will begin. "These invaders have been a terror to this galaxy long enough. They have distracted us from our enemies, and they have cost us lives, resources, and our very sanity in questioning whether they are truly there or not. But they are here. They are real and a tangible threat that will soon be purged from this galaxy. Glory to the Republic, and may its protection to the galaxy reign evermore." Glory to the Chancellor. Glory to the people. Glory.
All right, give me a persuasion roll with advantage there, Caesar.
All right, then. Advantage. Oh, why every time? Do we have any inspiration?
You guys have three.
May I?
Burn it.
Nice. And you guys will stay after. I was going to give you an inspiration point for the speech anyway. Definitely get a better turn of the crowd. You see the crowd definitely already worked up by the theatrics of the fleets ahead, and then Oviedo pumping them up, and then you coming through and kind of giving that decisive beat. You see them cheering, applauding, a big chant for the Republic, and for the Republic, for the Republic, going through. And you see Chancellor Oviedo kind of give you like a pat on the back, goes, with these men's help, we will take back our galaxy. I know that they go with your interest at heart. You see the crowd cheers, and you see ships beginning to take off, and you get your first clear look at the fleet that you all will be spearheading. You see that they've spared no expense on equipping this. And you definitely probably guess they've had to reallocate some of their kind of ships and assets, because it looks like they brought some of their best to help lead this investigation into the beyond. You see a lot of kind of the shiny hammerheads of the Republic capital class fleets, numerous of their top of the line starfighters and support ships, all arrayed, all ready to launch into the unknown of the galaxy. You see, after that, the kind of crowd begins to disperse. Unless you have anything to say to Supreme Chancellor Oviedo, you guys can hop aboard your ship and launch in.
Does anyone want to say something to him first? Caesar does want to say something.
Are we going to get the chance to say anything after? Is that
what you're implying? No, I'm just like, if anyone wants to go first, now's the time.
How about it, dude?
All right.
We'll try to bring our ship back in one piece.
I'll try to bring my ship back in one piece.
Caesar will look to the Chancellor, kind of chuckle to himself a bit, and will say, glory. We will destroy this threat for you, Chancellor. And once it is done, we will return and we will join in destroying the threat of the Dominion. I hope you will be prepared for the parades, the day the galaxy celebrates your victory, the Republic's victory.
You see, he kind of nods in. You see, like a little bit of evaluation in his eye, but he does smile, kind of his big Montgomery face, and he goes, that will be a glorious day. I do not do this for my own name. I watched my people burn as the Dominion came. There can be no true peace with savages such as that. You kind of see it looks back to where you spoke before, and then kind of gives you like a kind of a clear, like you did no inside check. Now he's kind of evaluating. He goes, I've struggled to place you. For the longest time, I thought you were a spy. You would bring some type of harm to the Republic. But your fervor seems genuine, though you still do not embody the principles that we of the Republic live by. He kind of looks at you afterwards.
I embody the change the Republic may need to undergo in order to fight back threats that originally I thought merely the Dominion of. Perhaps the Huts but more so it has been proven with the invaders. Swift, brutal, and though I have a bit of my own ego with my own collections and whatnot, those have nothing to do with what I represent. I represent swift, decisive, unmerciful action to our enemies.
You see, he nods and kind of, he thinks for a moment and says, I appreciate the need for swift and decisive action. That is something I've tried to bring to the Republic that I felt sorely lacking before I ascended to the Supreme Chancellorship. The brutality, though, that is not something I do wish to see myself, our Grand Army, or the Republic become. Your assistance has been gravely needed and necessary from what you and your allies have done. But I would ask you to embrace the nobility of being an officer of the Grand Army, to show no mercy, but not to present yourself as a savage. I feel you could go far in the military, and kind of looks back to where he gave the speech, even political life, with that recognized.
Caesar thinks about it for a moment, but looks to the Chancellor with a bit more of a serious face. I am of the belief that comfort is a poison. And if I were to fade into that nobility that so many others represent so wholeheartedly, that I would be a poison. I believe going out of one's comfort zone is necessary. I show an alternative. I believe, well and truly, that a little bit of horror, of savagery, can be used to prevent the true horrors and brutality that can come forth if it were to simply be ignored. From one victory, 1,000.
See, he kind of nods and goes, well, we shall see. That is not the way the Republic has done before, but I fear we have dark times ahead of us. Go consult the fleet and see if your one victory for 1,000 has any merit here.
He smiles and says, I've proven it. Time and time again, have I not? I shall prove it for you, the Republic, its people. And when I do, I apologize for what it is I do.
You see, he kind of gives a confused look for a moment before nodding. And kind of going, and start to busy himself with preparations for both the Senate and the fleet launch as well.
Could I roll something to further Caesar's good graces with the Chancellor from that?
Right now, he's going to be looking to see how you all fare. Right now, he's staked a lot of his political capital on getting both outfitting your guys' ship and then getting the fleet ready for battle, so he needs a win here for just especially with you all being pretty much his first act as this new emergency powers supreme chancellor.
I'm just gonna say to you, and I'm getting a lot of Dr. Talos is gonna die vibes from you, so.
Why is Dr. Talos gonna die?
I don't know. I don't know. Dr. Dichi's dead is how I feel. Anyways, I'm sending a message to my mom as I get on the ship.
Fair enough. when you all are able to get on the ship, don't forget if you haven't already, to mark in the Republic resources they gave you with the two med packs, the spacesuit, some incendiary rounds or incendiary grenades they could equip yourself with.
Those grenades or rounds, I give all of mine to Vars, so whatever combination or whatever that you want of whatever, choose.
I did, and rounds. Oh, lordy. Yeah.
I think you bought like a ton of it, extras too.
I've got like 13 cells.
You're ready to set some shit on fire.
Oh hell yeah. I mean, after reading what it does, like, oh, you hit them and then, oh, look, a pool of fire underneath them. Hell yes.
I don't know if any of you guys played Divinity, I forgot what it's called, Divinity Original Sin. It's like a computer game or a tackle game. But it's just like, I feel like one of the big things of that game, no matter what you do, fire just happens there. And like, it just keeps spreading. So I feel like this could be virus.
Yeah.
Like, everything always on fire. Yeah,
it'll be easier to tell which part of the planet isn't on fire versus which part is on fire.
It's gonna awaken some latent pyromania. That's just, oh hey, I didn't realize I liked it this much.
Talos purchases a fire extinguisher.
Something about that just reminds me of a clip of some guy pulling the thing off of it and throwing it into the fire like a grenade.
Yeah.
Why isn't it working?
Oh, it works. It blows up.
Yeah. Perfect. Well, you all are able to get into your ship and make your way into the upper space around the planet of Coruscant. You see the Republic fleet arrayed around you. And you see, I forgot to introduce him too. So you see the command staff for this fleet appear in a hologram around you and kind of a little look in front of your communications council. Two of them are very familiar. You see that Oveno placed General Vett in control of the ground forces for this operation, along with his Master Kalu as his advisor. You see, though, that the Admiral for this is a new, somebody you haven't met before. He introduces himself as Vexen. And Caesar, actually most of you all would probably have known about him in some capacity. He's one of the kind of up-and-coming admirals for the Republic. He is a Zabrakian man. He's got kind of the yellowish skin for the Zabraks. He's in a white admiral's uniform. And he has a pretty good reputation. He's a competent kind of a warrior at heart. He was a starfighter pilot for years before kind of gradually making his way up the ranks. He's definitely been a leading force behind some of the Republic's victories. And you will actually give me a lore roll too. Nice. Caesar and Talos, it definitely makes sense. Caesar on this side, you picked this up, and Talos, maybe you're reading the news one day. Oveno and Vexen have had a pretty long relationship. For a time, Oveno actually served under Admiral Vexen before heading into politics and leaving the military life behind after the burning of Mon Calamari. So they're a pretty close relationship, and especially since Oveno took control, Admiral Vexen's been one of he's been kind of the lead admiral out of the Republic fleet. Oveno's kind of put him on the high-profile missions. It definitely said you guys realize it's not like it's more of a nepotism thing. It's more of Oveno clearly just trusts Vexen to get the jobs done, so he's been kind of his go-to man for it. So it doesn't really surprise you guys to see him there. He's got a kind of a cold, taciturn nature, but definitely a good strategic thinker. And as he sees you guys pop up, and you kind of see him give a small nod, and goes, "Master Kalu and General Vect speak very highly of you. I am Admiral Vexen. Looking forward to working with you all during this expedition. I've been told by the Supreme Chancellor to take your advice at the highest level, and especially with your experience fighting these savages, I'll be very interested to hear your thoughts and opinions as we proceed forward. Don't fall into military discipline here. You are not our soldiers. You are consultants due to your expertise here. So if you have ideas, thoughts, bring them up, as long as you don't do it in a way that would hurt morale.
I'd say stop calling them savages.
You see, he kind of nods back and goes, expand on that. Why do you believe so? From the acts I've seen from your own reports, they seem like they are, they don't have any civility among them.
Well, when you say savages, it kind of implies a lack of tact, lack of intelligence, a simplistic sort of an enemy. But hell, they infiltrated the Dominion, they infiltrated the Senate. You might even have one or two of them on your ship. Don't call them, don't diminish the enemy calling them savages. They're savage, but they're not dumb.
You see, he kind of pauses for a moment. Like he definitely kind of clearly had thought. And he still looks back at you, meets you in the eye, or meets you in the visor, I should say. Yeah. but he goes, you're right. It's easy to underestimate an enemy you don't understand. I'll take that to heart.
Hope it helps.
Caesar looks proud. Oh my god, my brain has done the thing. I forgot the name.
Bars. Okay, bars.
Yeah.
Took me a second. Sorry about that.
No worries.
He looks proud.
It's okay, Caesar. We'll kill you later.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. Has Vexen and Caesar ever come to blows when Caesar worked back with the Dominion?
I'll leave that up to you. So you're probably not like in a, actually like a, you'd probably be on like a smaller role of commanding a force of the Dominion, not the overall admiral that they'd be going up against, but you probably come across areas where he's been in command.
Yeah, that's what I was talking about. I'd say, yeah. So Caesar would respect this man greatly if he is of very high competence.
He's definitely, he was one of the first new guard generals to be put in the war that wasn't like a general that had been kind of serving over peacetime and kind of got, he's definitely kind of a new, younger, more warrior breed than the Republic usually has for their kind of high admirals.
Would it be all right to say that Caesar has lost to this man a fair few times before then?
Yeah, good, for sure.
Absolutely. And Caesar would nod to him and kind of say, who would have thought one of these days I shall bring you victory, even though many times in the past you've served me defeat.
You see, he's not, like, he's almost like he pauses for a moment, unsure how to respond, and he goes, I fear with this upcoming war, we may have to do a lot of things we're not comfortable in doing. I guess I'll have to get comfortable with serving alongside the Butcher. But it's peace and stability that matter. So I will put that in the safety of the Galactic Republic first.
Caesar would nod to that, smiling.
You see, he goes, you see a little hologram, a pop-up. My thoughts are that we retrace the fleet's movements. I want us to go to Vela. We've had trouble getting reports out of the system recently, so we're going to launch our fleet into the system and see what we can uncover there. We don't believe the fleet is stationed, or their fleet, or hostile presence is a large force there. But we just want to get an accurate reading on the system since its destruction and see if we can find any clues or resources to indicate what the Vong are doing or where they may be stationed. Once we launch in, we will have with you all being the foremost experts in this field, we'll have you all lead and see what information you can gather, and hopefully we can find a trail for these monsters. And with that, he'll kind of leave it open for questions, but if not, you'll see him kind of give a curt nod, cutting off the hologram field, and you'll start to see the fleet of the Republic begin to wink out of existence as they make the jump to hyperspace. You guys, I should say, is there anything else you have to say or anything else you all want to do before jumping?
Talos is going to send a message to his mommy. And it's not going to be like a live message. He's going to do a recording and ask Jarvis to record while he's in kind of his private room. Mother, as you know, I'm going on this Republic expedition, and there's no guarantee of what the outcome might be. I want you to know that when I get back, I think I'm going to return to the lab. Please tell Father and Ren that I miss them. I'll see you when I return. Please send that, Jarvis.
Of course. Sending now.
And he will exit and then join the rest of everybody and wherever they are and prepare for going into the unknown.
Perfect. And one thing I almost forgot to do. So who are you guys bringing with you today with this adventure? Are you guys taking the Black Sun hired HK with you or the Keba, the Jedi Knight?
I think we should take the Jedi Knight, whose page I still haven't finished. Keba Bama. Only because it rhymes with Nova Kana.
It does, actually. I didn't realize it.
It has to be him now. But I was about to make a joke of, companion that will have difficulty versus the Yuuzhan Vong, or companion that would have difficulty versus the Yuuzhan Vong. Force user one, or droid.
One that enrages them, and the other one they want to kill.
Which one?
Choices. Admiral guy, I missed that. Sorry, I missed the whole thing. My computer just randomly died. Who was the Admiral again?
Vexen. He's a Zabrakian Admiral. High-level overview. Fairly, very competent. Kind of a tact-turn guy.
And is he on our ship, or was he through
Hollow? Oh, no, he's on his flagship. The Indomitable, a large, kind of top-of-the-line Hammerhead Capital Cruiser from the Republic.
Okay. I was just going to force check him just in case. Make sure he's there. Not letting some guy on the ship when I'm sleeping.
If it does give you any comfort, I should say, Master Kalu is on that ship with him. You blanked out. So General Vett is leading the ground forces, and Master Kalu is along with them. They are both on the Indomitable as well.
Okay.
I got a question. Oh, sorry.
I had another question, so go ahead and ask yours.
Caesar would inquire about being allowed to help train troops, the greener troops, or anyone who would really accept his training during the little excursion we're doing here.
Definitely. If you brought it up, especially through General Vett, Vett would definitely let you kind of train some of the ground forces, especially on different maneuvers. For tactics you've seen from the Yuuzhan Vong and just kind of how they operate in ground combat.
He's going to make them into monsters.
He'll make a man out of you.
That's what Tegan, how many force powers for the Jedi with no force powers right now?
Oh, forgot how many.
I see level 6 at the top of the page, but it's not adding up to what I see.
Is he a guardian?
Yeah, he's a guardian.
Do you go by the class level for companion?
No, they have a different amount, but I gave them more than they're supposed to have. And I thought I wrote that down, but I must not have.
I'm not familiar with all that, so.
So don't use, because they really depower the companions' powers on that side. So I think I gave them half the number. So we'll give them seven. I think I said six initially, but do seven. You round them up. It's 13 he's supposed to have at level six, so let's round up. I think he's only supposed to have two powers if you do the companion thing, which I'm like, that kind of sucks.
What the?
an apprentice stat block, you know, who's okay, not meant to have a lot.
Seven powers?
Seven powers, yeah.
Okay.
My mind immediately went back to Kirk being able to heal.
The force healing Rancor. Yeah, so I mean, it works for companions. You don't want your companions to be like too power, but I think I wish they had like sidekick rules on top of the companion rules, since they give a little bit more breadth. But that's all. That's exactly what we don't need, is more weird differentiations for stuff. So
another book.
Yeah.
Sorry. What's his max level? First or second?
Second. Yeah.
Okay.
He's a bearable.
They don't get a second.
Give him invisibility.
they don't give him a second level until level 11 for the companion one, right?
Yeah, running it rules is written. Yeah. Yeah. So I modified that a little bit for both HK and the other guy, just so he could be a little bit more useful to the party.
Yeah, at that point he's just fodder. And, like, he's already at a disadvantage for the whole being a force user. Hey, go fight that enemy that you can't sense.
That's why I gave him the brawler style. Brawler style and smites aren't too bad, so just beat him up and keep using the force to beat him up.
Yeah, that works.
Caesar, did you get a new movie by any chance?
Oh, I've
seen this Hollow a few times.
Could Caesar see if there was if any of the soldiers he's going to be training had contraband, and if that contraband was in flight movie?
It won't be a D20. We'll say 10 plus. I think you could probably, I think in the military you could bring movies with you. We'll just have to see if they're a fan of that movie. So D20. You kind of find one of the soldiers, because this is a rom-com, if I remember right. We asked, like, he's like a little slightly embarrassed, but he kind of raises his hand and goes, sir, I do have a copy of that in my book, sir. I could bring that for inspection.
Do so with haste.
So he will definitely bring that. And they will, because you'll probably have to spend a bit on the Indomitable, but before you guys kind of launch into the system, they will meet back up with the Nova Khanna for the last leg. So you can hang with the crew, watch a movie, and be ready for jumping into the system.
Every once in a while, while watching the movie, if the guy's still there, if we don't kick him out, Caesar will occasionally just look at him, dead neutral face, just to scare the shit out of him.
He's definitely like a little bit, he's a private, very new to newer to the army, he's low rank, I should say. But definitely, he kind of he's sweating bullets throughout this. Perfect. Yeah, but you all are able to kind of spend the day preparing, training the troops, watching your movies, and just getting ready for this expedition into the unknown. But eventually, you do reach the system of Vela. You see as the blur of the hyperspace recedes, kind of leaving those blue streaked lines and taking you back into the dark blackness of space, you find the area where the Vela once stood especially still. The last two times you've seen this area, the first time when you landed, it was a buzz with the Dominion and Republic ships kind of engaging and skirmishing and in their positions around the planet. And then when you left it, it was a buzz with the Yuuzhan Vong ships attacking those Dominion and Republic cruisers and the explosion that the planet made when Vela met its end. But now it's just still. You don't see any Yuuzhan Vong ships. You see the space around the planet is just limited, like filled with wreckage of both Dominion and Republic cruisers. You see asteroids created by the planet's explosion floating around throughout the system. But both the party scanners on your ship, the Nova Kana, and you'll see the fleet report in that they don't pick up any sign of hostile ships within the area.
How close of a look are they taking at the asteroids?
You'll see Admiral Vexen pop in, and he'll go, "We're running a full sensor sweep across the asteroids. So far, we've not picked up any sign of these invaders. We would appreciate if you could aid in our scouting efforts and see if you could find any traces of them within the system, or anything that may indicate they've been back since the destruction of Velia."
All right. Guys.
And I will say, too, this will be using the ship stuff. But you guys can look around and see the area. You see kind of like tons of asteroids filling the space. You see the wreckage of Republican Dominion ships. You see just numerous things on that side. Definitely let me know if you guys were looking for a clue there, but there's definitely some things you all can take a look at around the area that may give you a little bit of inquiry into what's going on
here. I'm gonna have Jarvis probe and scan, if possible, all the wreckage and just the area all around the fleet in general, as far out as possible.
So sorry, that it's safe to say that there's no other like planetary bodies in that general vicinity, right?
Yeah, definitely nothing else. Vela didn't have a moon, and yeah, it's pretty. It was a sun like a distance away, but outside of that, it's pretty clear.
All right, is Jarvis advanced enough to calculate? All right, so if that thing blew outward, right, one big explosion from the planet, is it Jarvis capable of kind of predicting where things should be and maybe sort of picking out anything that doesn't match up?
Definitely roll an astrogation check for us.
The hell? I don't know how to astrogate.
it'll be over in the tools area on the page, yeah.
Deb.
All right. Apparently I can.
Nice. So go in order on this one. So for the probing, it takes quite a while for Jarvis to be able to break through the data. It takes a couple hours like looking through and just kind of probing into this. He doesn't find any ship activity with his kind of sensor suite, but it does see that there have been frequent gravitational anomalies within the system that match up to some of the records of his that he's seen before with the Yuuzhan Vong craft. Some of them have been in the system as frequently as about 4 or 5 hours ago. 4 or 5 hours from you guys arriving into the system. Let me get through the next few pieces here. With the astrogation piece and kind of looking at the kind of the debris positioning, you'll see that there has been significant, you're kind of looking at the projectile or the model that Jarvis projected. Vars, you're able to see that a lot of this debris is not matching what should have taken place. You can even notice that some of the asteroid pieces have been kind of segmented out, and other, like some of the wreckage pieces have been kind of moved to. It looks like they're definitely clearly kind of been manually manipulated into certain categories. Still made to look a little haphazard, but definitely not what would be naturally occurring from an explosion like that.
The Yuuzhan flies rocks, and we're in an asteroid field. I don't like this.
Yeah, you're not alone in that. Let's make sure that the our Republic escort fleet, hell, I don't know what to call them, make sure they're aware of this. I'd rather they get not get caught off guard if we can avoid it.
Caesar is, I forget what the deployment's called, but he is in the comms room, coordinator. So he'll get that information sent away immediately.
You'll have the admiral kind of acknowledge that he received it and let him know that his fleet is on high alert as well.
He'll also warn that the Yuuzhan Vong usually have something to disconnect comms from longer ranges. If I'm remembering that right?
Yeah, they did deploy that at Vela, so they were able to take down some of the planetary communications on the planet.
Yep, so be prepared for comms to go dark if something starts to go down.
We've done.
Kalos will pass the information about the gravity anomalies, but I'd also like Jarvis to look into that and see if there's any more information specifically about these gravity anomalies that he can maybe garner. Would data be useful in that regard?
Because this, in the kind of a little refresher, the Yuuzhan Vong use the gravity to kind of power their ships. So it's kind of they do their propulsion and make their jumps to hyperspace. What would Jarvis be looking for?
I guess if I'm understanding that correctly, and with that in mind, maybe a direction of travel, if there's any sort of trail of travel from that point.
Definitely make an astrogation check. Yeah, reviewing through and kind of takes some time for him to sift through, but he's able to quickly do this a little bit easier than he was looking for finding the gravitational signals initially, but he's able to plot through the jumps. You kind of find that there's multiple spots around the system where they jumped, but they all seem to be heading in a similar direction. And kind of plotting it backwards, he's finding that they're kind of jumping into another, an unnamed system, or unnamed planetary group within the Terminus system. Excuse me, on the very edges of the Terminus system.
I will immediately forward all that data and information to Admiral Vexen. And then, of course, General Vec and... Master Kalu to just keep everybody informed and in the loop.
So with the, would we be familiar with that system? Like maybe what planet they might be at in the system?
So it's a unnamed, unclaimed system. So that's, you know that there is an inhabitable planet in that group, as well as kind of a blue gas giant, that was hard to say, in the system as well, and then kind of a star too, an older star.
So I'm trying to think, we've kind of gone over everything, haven't we? Gotta be something else we're not piecing together here.
Is there a reason? Would I be able to infer a reason as to why they would go to a system like that?
Oh, that one? Uninhabitable off of anybody's kind of hyperspace charts.
Just kind of a place to hide.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, basically it was one that's not likely to be stumbled across unless somebody was going there on purpose.
Oh, so we might potentially have the upper hand. An element of surprise, perhaps, unless, of course, spies.
On that note, how far away is this by travel? Is it a direct hop?
Direct hop, about 5 hours away.
So the last people we figure were probably here about 5 hours ago, and it takes about 5 hours. Okay.
So we, by technicality, just missed them.
Which, well. So I wasn't here when this thing blew up. We already did a scan for things that like aren't like missed, like satellites that weren't there, like moons and things.
You didn't find these satellites, but you did find in the first, with Varz's astrogation check, that they did appear like they were grouping up sections or asteroids of the planet's remains into certain areas.
Love those rocks. Okay. But everything looks like it's supposed to be here, just in a different configuration than the planet that's expected to be here.
Give me a scan check.
Okay. It's with the ship, right?
Tegan, do the rocks and the spaceships all floating together look almost like a, like they're trying to build up a little bit of a battle zone? Kind of like how people will set up sandbags for cover.
Definitely. So as you kind of look through and kind of help, or probably work with Uli on that side, they don't look like it doesn't look like it's a battleground. But as you scan those kind of the asteroids or remains of the planet, it looks like they've been mining them. They've been taking some of the resources out of these asteroids, and you kind of see like indents and it looks like almost like creatures biting out through these asteroids and sifting through the resources for what's actually useful. You see the kind of the ones that have been grouped up are ones that have been mined already, and the ones that are kind of free forming are the ones that still have resources intact within them. You can kind of pick up on your sensors.
Is there any sort of trace we could pick up off the ones that maybe the ones that haven't? I don't trying to think of what would be the difference between the two.
Oh, from the way they're positioned, you may just think it's just timing. Because one of the things too that you're able to kind of get from the scans or some of the ones that's the latest look at the asteroid was that last asteroid appeared to get, it's still a little warm, still glowing. It has like a heat trace. That looking through your system appears to have been from this day.
Would there be any creatures still inside any of these asteroids? Kind of like them leaving and letting whatever's mining keep mining.
You don't see any traces of creatures within the asteroid from your scans. But everybody that's proficient in insight, give me an insight check.
Oh, I'm good at that.
All right, Caesar and Vars, if it makes sense, the two kind of the ones who have been involved in larger warfare would pick up on this. The timing's too exact. It looks like these creatures cleared out pretty much right before you all were due to arrive. You're not picking up anything kind of close in system, but you probably have some. You probably guess they'd have some way of tracking when somebody's going to hyperspace into the system in advance warning enough for them to clear out before the people arrive.
In that case, Caesar's going to immediately call back to the fleet and let them know Vong already knew we were coming. They cleared out. They likely know we're going to arrive at wherever they are. Stay sharp.
Is there any chance that you can try and reach out, if that's the right word for it, with the Force? And see where? Vars is going to gesture at the vastness of space.
Well, yeah, I hate to admit it, but my skill's not that good. I mean, if we're looking at it, or I can, you know, have a general idea, much more narrow in focus, I can probably suss it out with some time. It'll take a while. But I think it's one of those things I'm probably going to need to be close to or have some better sight of. You get me within sight of it, I can pick anything out, but...
Well, it's a good thing a Jedi Master tagged along. Caesar, can you... You reach the flagship and have Master Luvano. Kalu. Wow. Oh, yeah. No, definitely not a Jedi. And you have Master Kalu try to. Is it reach out? Really?
For what?
Reach out. Yeah. Reach out with the force.
Yeah.
For a second, when you were saying that, when you said, "Hey, Caesar," my brain immediately went to, "But I'm not Darth Jar Jar." I didn't go counselor for him. I went scholar. he'll quickly try and ping Kalu.
Kalu go up on and go, "Hello, my friends." Kind of after hearing a run through, and he goes, "I believe myself and some of the other Force users, Zuli, yourself included, we could try to see if we could reach out with the Force and kind of feel where they are not. It may take a couple of hours, if that is acceptable to you all."
See, I wasn't lying. Even the Jedi Master's going to take a couple hours.
I wasn't down on your ability, Zuli. Better to get more heads on it.
Cover more ground a lot quicker.
Yeah, because who knows if these things are just hiding? Maybe they're still here, but they're just out of sight.
Well, that's the thing. How would they? If it feels like they were here, or they were here and then jumped almost like before we got here, so they've got to have some way to detect us coming in, or they either know our itinerary, which we already know they can infiltrate places, so that's probably a part of the reason, but they might, maybe there's some sort of perimeter defense or something in the, where would be the, I assume Tegan, it's a couple stops to get here, like it wasn't just a direct route through hyperspace, we had to change out and
definitely was a direct route. You probably guess if anything was tracking kind of your arrival, it would be in system of how quickly they knew, or kind of how exactly they knew when the time you would be arriving in, okay, for the things to be able to pull out. And
so we would have been like outer edge of the system when it first went off, and then as we make our way in, they've scooted.
Basically, as kind of detects, or we think is a detects a signal, it boots them out before you revert.
Well, I suppose we can get started with the mental probe, but it'd probably be a good idea to look for whatever they've got, at the very least, if we want to come back here, destroy their warning system, give us an end. I don't know.
Either way, we shouldn't remain here too long. Took them 5 hours to leave. If they were expecting us, it may take far less time for their attack fleets to jump in.
All right, so you want to head to that lonely little center of space in the Terminus system.
So are you guys, are you looking for it, or are you guys bouncing?
We could look for it. I mean, it won't do us any good if they know we're coming.
Yeah.
Caesar's genuinely worried of Vong already being in the system. And when we jump over there, we're going to get ambushed, and Vong from this system coming over will be pincered.
All right.
That's his concern.
Well, if you want to take the time, try to feel it out, maybe you just blow up a few asteroids, see what happens.
That may be a good idea, but we need to be careful with which ones we target.
These are the asteroids, or are these pieces of the planet, Vela?
Yeah, they're pieces of the planet.
Oh boy. Hey guys, there's Tabana gas inside these. We probably don't want to do that.
Well, maybe we made sure we're parked a little further away, but yeah.
We can fire at the already mined ones.
Dash,
we don't want another Paragus.
So happy. Asteroids that blow up. I mean, what more could that guy ask for?
Yeah. Nice little life day present. I'm going to record this for him. One sec.
So getting on the mental probe while they're deciding what to do, are there any objects that would look like good candidates to check out first? I mean, like the bigger chunks are the ones that look a little odd shaped, or more, maybe not odd, but more, I get rock is natural, but like, we know what their ship profiles look like. What would be the closest thing to that, or something similar to their technology, versus a planet that just blew up? and is in chunks.
Definitely. So you guys know for at least the immediate area around Vela was, there are no life signals there. So you don't see any life forms there. So it's probably going to be kind of the surrounding areas. But you could definitely kind of start kind of probing where we may think hyperspace lanes are kind of the best areas to probe or kind of examine hyperspace.
So I'd probably do it along our... how many vectors, do we know how many vectors roughly there were to enter the system? Like, are there only like a couple ways you can do it safely, or is it all over?
There are a couple different vectors. The biggest thing for this piece will be, are you guys spending the time to review? Yeah, this will be one that's not kind of a quick one to be able to go through and find it. It's definitely kind of the proverbial needle in a haystack.
Is this something Uli could do with the ship while they're hashing out whatever, or is it?
Unfortunately, unless they decide to go and just blow up all of the asteroids of the system, which Uli could definitely use the ship in his kind of his mental awareness there, but it's definitely what it would take for the load take longer than their conversation and even them shoot a couple blasters at the asteroids.
Well, what do we want to do? I mean, I'm up for we can just follow our vector back because that's the way we came in. So if they knew where we were coming, just follow that back and then look for a few things, probably take an hour or two, but...
Wait, what if we just blow up, like, 5 or 7 of them? Maybe 12? And, see if there's any sort of reaction, you know? Right? Because if I'm, like, hiding under hiding in a crate or something, I'm in a warehouse, and they start smashing crates, suddenly I'm thinking this isn't the best hiding spot.
They are disciplined, however. And they do not fear death.
Yeah, well, maybe they're worried about us discovering something, and that's worse than death. Hell, I don't know. Maybe I just want to put on a light show for Dash.
Caesar, we kind of smile at that. If that does not work, we may want to try falsely hyper-jumping to see if they simply detect something akin to the emissions or... something. I'm not quite a mechanic myself.
Yeah. Talking about a micro jump. Jump out, view it from afar, and then see what happens when we leave.
I wasn't, but that sounds good.
That would be one way to do it. Jump to the edge of the system where we came in, if it's a clear path. And then just try to focus and find that whatever was detecting us.
All right.
It's maybe, an option.
Maybe we take a different path, not in the direction of the Terminus system, but one of the other ones, and just kind of
no, the path that we came in from, because they'll be if they detected us, then if we go along the path that we came in on, they'll likely detect us again if it's something in the system. So if it's something in the system, it's probably, I'm guessing, along our path. But if it could detect us out there, we can get to the point where we think it might have been detecting us, then we'll kind of be able to figure out where it is.
All right, maybe I'm overthinking.
Kind of working backwards.
I know, but let's say I'm you know, I'm the big bad Vong. And, I can't wait for these idiots to come check out the wreckage of Vela. And then they show up, and then they just leave the same way they came, maybe 20 minutes into it. It's kind of strange, right? So do you kind of get where I'm running with this or no? It's like, oh yeah, Vela's still blowing
up.
All
right, but I don't know,
boys.
These guys strike me like they're just itching for a fight anyway. It doesn't matter where you find them. They wake up angry enough to kill you.
So if they're here,
they don't need a reason. Living is their reason for killing.
Yeah. So if they're here, then why aren't they?
I don't know.
It would be such hell if there actually genuinely wasn't any Vong in this system.
Yeah, that's like, damn it, they're winning.
If you want us to do our force detection, it's going to need to be now.
Right. I see the ships already started firing.
Can we potentially get an advantage towards this detection if they do their force thing, and Jarvis continues to do scans and maybe scan asteroids, specifically comparing them against, you know, our first encounter with the Vong, because I mean, what did it look like? It looked like a giant asteroid, right? And we currently see asteroids before us. So there's that. And then also keeping our distance, considering the explosive nature of what we're dealing with right now with Tabana gas.
Definitely. So I'll be there won't be a role for this piece. With the way you guys are set up between Jarvis's setup and the Jedi reaching out with the Force, you'll be able to find if there is anything in the system. It's just more with the vast area. It's just going to be a time constraint more than anything.
I'm better safe than sorry.
All right.
Come on. All right, somebody else take the helm. This is going to take a while. And Uli will just kind of sit in the co-pilot's chair and cross his feet and
I can take the helm.
All right, I'll
start blowing some asteroids up.
I mean, maybe just a few, you know, just to
pass. Fire the missiles.
Yeah, just some of the past the time.
Perfect. Be right back.
Would we know potentially what sort of technology they might be using? Like, how much of their technology?
You'd guess they're probably something alive. You'd guess if they had something up on that side. Unfortunately, you've not seen much of their hyperspace tech too close. You've seen some of their other propulsion pieces, but you're not really sure what type of thing they engineer or genetically engineer.
The person would look for, because I've read all these books. I don't remember what Uli actually would even know.
So. He wouldn't know too much, unfortunately.
He's just looking for something odd.
Yeah.
All right. Can I just say, I know there's no real check for it, but a gut check, if you will. Vars is going to take a look at all the asteroids and just kind of start with that one.
For sure. And Vars, you create like a great video for Dash. You kind of going through and finding different asteroids to explode. A few of them was the Tavana gas reserves. You have some crazy explosions arcing out from the ruins of Vela. As you not only destroy the remains of the planet, but you're denying the Yuuzhan Vong a resource in case they came back. Because they've been eating or been consuming and kind of repurposing the minerals around the planet. So you're able to go through and just start some world-class explosions, keeping yourself and the fleet safe as you go through and deprive them of future resources that could be kind of fall into their hands. After some time and then the explosions go through, Uli when the Kalu and some of the computing powers of Jarvis and the Republic fleet are eventually able to locate something that does stand out. This is on the very far edges of the system, kind of away from the asteroids and wreckage of Vela. It's almost blinking, you miss it. It's the size of about like a poodle dog. It's not huge. It's this little scarab-like beetle creature. And you see, after kind of feeling it out and feeling its empty portion in the Force, you guys are able to spot it. And you see, as you scan through, its life signs are so low that it's almost impossible to reach it by a scanner. And I assume you all probably do a little bit of a test with jumping to hyperspace, like you mentioned. When you jump to hyperspace, you see its wings beat. It does send out like a little sonar-like signal throughout the area of space.
Huh.
Well, that would explain how they saw us coming.
Outside of
spies being within the fleet and passing that information along, they seem to have a detection system.
Yeah. After we did that jump, does anything change in the asteroid field?
Nothing changes within the asteroid field. Right. You see, after it kind of beats its wings and does the thing, and then it goes back into like a inert state.
Kind of want to catch that thing.
That's what I'm wondering. Do we catch it or do we destroy it? What's what's the play here?
Well,
I guess maybe this is something for the fleet. This isn't something we need to decide.
Yeah.
Are they in the loop on this?
They probably got.
Yeah, I assume you guys let Admiral Vexen know.
Yeah.
I guess he had pondered it for a moment. If we do capture it, I'd recommend leaving either in a pod or a small ship behind with it. I wouldn't want to bring it into the next system with how many hyperspace signals you all found from the other ships leaving into there. I wouldn't want to give them any unnecessary advantage. And as you said, these creatures can do astounding things. I would not want to learn what they could do too late.
Yeah. All right, well, does it look like it's actually reacting to us in any sort of way?
It doesn't. You guys can kind of fly around it. It's pretty much just stays inert.
All right. It
just might just detect a hyperspace when we come out of hyperspace or the reentry. I'm assuming gives off some sort of energy that's detectable. So
yeah, kind of like an alarm. It detects a certain thing and then, you know, it blinks or it does whatever.
Well, if we do put this in something and leave it behind, small suggestion, maybe wire that thing with a bunch of explosives. Because if I get a feeling that these guys, I mean, we've seen what they do to technology. If we find that we've encased one of their living things in machinery, well, I don't think they'll be happy.
Yeah.
But we'll get a few of them, maybe take a few of them out with it. You know, at the very least, if they destroy our equipment, we kill a couple of theirs, you know.
You see General Vett nod and go, yeah, we can spare a few explosives.
All right. So let's wrap that sucker up and then head to Terminus.
Perfect. You see their Republic fleet kind of sends a ship out to handle that. And you see the ship is able to both kind of lock it in, that creature in with a tractor beam. And you see them send a couple of their operatives out in spacesuits. And they basically put it into a small container. You see it are loaded with frag mines. That'll be set to blow in case somebody else outside of the Republic tries to capture it. So you see Admiral Vexen looks to the group and goes, so I do worry that they know that at least we came here in numbers with their creature. If they can detect hyperspace, they're not sure if the creature can count how many creatures or how many ships traverse through those lanes, or if it is a difference between a single ship and a fleet. But I do worry that they know how much of a resource we brought to bear as we go into this next location. Just wanted to share that with you and let you know to be aware and be ready for anything.
Should we stagger our entry?
You see, he kind of thinks about it and goes, it depends. This is, and he gestures to the fleet. This is one of the greatest fleets the Republic has put together. Personally, I would go in hard, shock and awe, see if we can take them off guard and drive the fight to them. I worry that if we split ourselves into pieces, we'd be picked apart.
All right, you had me at shock and awe.
I'm back.
But if they've had 5 hours to prepare, plus any other defenses that might have just they've been constructing just because, you know, they need to defend whatever's there. springing the trap, I guess, is one way to go. I feel like, what if we rush headlong into a wall and get stuck between that and the hard place, you know?
Are there any other ways into the Terminus system?
For this system, this probably guess why another reason why they chose it. There's one kind of hyperlane that intersects within it. So there's pretty much one approach into the planet.
Well, we came here to give them hell.
Do we have tractor beams?
I don't know if the Novacana does or not.
He's more asking that of the fleet.
Oh, yeah, the fleet has ships with tractor beams.
Why not take some asteroids with us? Impromptu bombs. Set up a bit of a minefield when we get in. So they can't escape. Not easily, at least. Or if they try, we just get a few blasts in there.
Yeah, Admiral, how skilled are your tractor beam techs?
Can I see ponder it? But probably enough that we could launch some of these kind of radium asteroid missiles at them. It might be the most accurate, but can cause a little bit of chaos as we show up.
Well, I mean, both the Republic and Dominion wanted Vela for its potential weaponry, and I don't see why we shouldn't use it.
Can I see him not go? Well, I agree. I'll send some of my techs to see if we can take a few with some of our larger ships and launch them out as we get there, either for screening for our own defenses or just launching them into the enemy formations if they are prepared for us.
Let's see how these dirtbag-like rocks thrown at them.
An object in motion stays in motion until another force stops it.
It all comes full circle. They use rocks against us. We use rocks against them.
Damn right.
Perfect.
This is the craziest adventure I've ever been on. I wish I was back in the garden in the lab. I don't know how I got tapped for this project. I really don't.
Is that worthy of an inspiration?
Sure, I'll give you guys one. That side, so you guys have three. Sweet.
Plan B, rocks.
Rocks.
Brought you a gift. Happy housewarming.
And Vela sends his regards. Kablooing. All right, well, it's 5 hours, right?
It is.
How long is that rom-com? Yeah. You can watch it a couple times.
Oh, man.
Might be the last movie we watch, boys. Let's put it on. Get out that rest of that pretzels.
I somewhat want to rewatch that fight of yours against that senator. It's short, but the rewatchability is endless.
Well, you mean the 3 seconds of explosions that happened? Yeah. That was pretty awesome.
Yeah, it was delicious.
Yeah, you guys like roasted those guys. Explosion, grenade, dash grenades.
I think I punched a guy.
You did.
You killed a guy with a trident. You should
knock
him for a little while.
Whoops.
Well,
perfect. Well, you guys are able to spend the 5 hours in hyperspace preparing. You see Keba meditating, enjoying in with you guys when you do turn the movies and the explosion fest on as well. He'll join in with the revelry. But eventually you do get the chime for your system that it is about to revert from hyperspace. And as that chime goes off, and you guys are probably prepared, is that even before that? But you feel the ship lurch. Like you still had like a minute or two in hyperspace, but you feel the ship kind of just torn out of hyperspace violently. As you look around you, you see the Republic fleet in the same position, kind of all pulled out, still in formation. But ahead of you, you see a chaotic scene. You see a raid around the planet, a fleet of coral-based asteroid Yuuzhan Vong ships. And the ships you've seen so far, you've seen a couple other capital ships before, but you see kind of just a raid around this planet, just legions of the Vong capital ships. You see swarming with their coral skippers, as well as their gunboats. This is one of the first true fleets you've seen from the Yuuzhan Vong, a raid in front of you. You see, and kind of taking notice, and probably the warrior, the ones with the military experience of the group will notice that this is a large fleet. It actually kind of out, it outnumbers the Republic fleet sent with you all to protect, to kind of investigate this area. But as you all appear, you see the fleet swarm, burst of plasma begins to fill the air. You see turbo lasers from the Republic ships match those bursts, and the sky becomes alight with chaos as this battle is joined. You hear the Admiral Vexen kind of come over the comms, still keeping his cool, but he goes, "All right, all ships fall into formation. Nova Khanna, we would like you all to deal with some of these fighters and gunboats. Keep them away from our capital craft. We're outnumbered here, but hey, we're going to give them hell. Show these criffers that we're the Republic. Call in if you need assistance. Stay connected. Stay frosty out there." And you see the ships begin to spring into action as he kind of gets the Republic in fighting order. But you see that the Yuuzhan Vong fleet seems to be flying in lockstep a little bit. Anybody who's proficient in insight, roll me an insight check.
I really wish I had taken that skill.
You did? Oh.
I did not. It's like the one I chose not to take out of all of the options I got.
Well, I think Talos would be too busy at whatever point. As soon as the Admiral stopped talking. Jarvis, I want scans on everything. And as like the Nova Khanna's about to take, you know, its maneuvers with our amazing pilot Uli at the helm right now. Jarvis, I want scans on all of those large ships. I want critical nodes identified immediately and pass those to the Admiral as soon as possible. And I'll start making my way back to my engine room and technician station.
Definitely. Yeah, your Jarvis is able to pull up some of the scans, sharing. You kind of see data coming both ways, with you guys sharing data with the fleet, and the fleet sharing data back. You see kind of numerous capital ships and vessels kind of arrayed. One of the big things that your scanners and the fleet scanners pick up, too, is that there's just gravitic anomalies around the system. And actually, give me a probe. Give me a scan check for the... for the Nova Khanna. Yeah, you see that this planet just is chock full of like it has the planet almost is pulling out the gravitational pull in the surrounding system, almost as if it was its own star. It is pulling in significant gravity, which is what pulled you out of hyperspace early, and is what's keeping the ships locked in step. Within the system, preventing them from exiting back down the hyperspace lane.
So is it affecting us regardless of proximity? We're just affected?
Yeah, so it's basically blanketing the system.
Okay.
It has like the gravitational pull of a star. And with Caesar and Vars, you all notice kind of seeing the Yuuzhan Vong ships arrayed in front of you. You've seen fancy flying. Between both of the Mandalorians, Dominion, the Republic, you've seen hotshot Jedi, you've seen Mandalorians who, with more piloting skills and sense to pull off some maneuvers. But you've never seen this large of a fleet move as the way they have. Their fighters, their gunboats, their capital ships almost seem to be moving as if they were one. Like one hand, one body moving in joint function as they're approaching your ships and kind of approaching this battle. Almost like they're being coordinated. Like you guys kind of feel like you'd guess they were droids if you knew they weren't kind of vehemently hating droids. Like they're really just in sync, almost coordinated in their movements.
Well, crap.
Talos, can you have Jarvis look for anything that looks like that might be a signal antenna or something that's broadcasting commands to all these ships? Because the way they're moving doesn't make sense. It's like they're moving like those damn lizards.
That makes complete sense. Jarvis, you heard that. Look for a hive mind.
Jarvis, unfortunately, through the gravitational anomalies on the planet, is not able to pick anything up outside of that.
Well, that'll make it easier on us. Less people to psych out.
Okay. Does Jarvis like tell me that?
Yeah.
That he's having. Okay. So I guess as soon as I hear that knowledge, Uli, it seems Jarvis is having some issues with you up there in the front. We need to focus on looking for any. Well, no, he didn't roll insight. We need to look for something that looks like it's controlling all these fighters, since they're moving in unison.
All of them are?
They seem to be. I mean, I'm assuming that we're just on comm, so everybody can hear this. Bars and
yeah.
And everyone. But so, are there any that look like they're moving a little less out of sync, like they're maybe out of range of something? Or do they all look like they're pretty much exhibiting the exact same level of coordination?
They do. So kind of the scene around you. So you guys see their public fleet in the midst of you and at your back. You see a star behind you guys. And the Yuuzhan Vong fleet is arrayed around the planet in front of you.
Well, wow. It could be like the thing that's stopping us in system. I mean, it could be that thing. It's got a strong enough pull that it... Who knows?
Well, it looks like we fight until we figure it out.
Yeah.
Those asteroids, how powerful would they be if they crashed into that planet?
You would probably guess they'd probably shoot those asteroids before they got through the planet.
All right.
Ah, crap, Vong. Off they go.
I mean, there's a whole. Unfortunately, you guys definitely use it for some defensive placement. But there is a whole. They're not going to let you guys bombard their planet with asteroids.
Fair enough. Fair enough.
Well,
perfect.
Well, go ahead. Is there any? Do I get any sense? Just feeling out. Like, does this coordination look like something I might have seen before? Besides, like the droids.
It doesn't look like anything you've seen before, but you can make a wisdom save if you like.
Yeah, I just want to see if there's anything out there that I can kind of detect. Just throwing the force out there, scanning, giving a cursory glance at the ships. Save, you said? Okay.
It's Geonosium time.
Yeah, so you looking through and kind of reaching out with the force, you still kind of feel the blankness from the Vong, but you do feel... something odd on the planet. It kind of feels muted, like you felt from the Voxen. Rather than the hunger, you just kind of feel a presence.
It's just the one?
Just the one.
Do I know how big? Like, do I get any sense of how big it is, or is it just...
Feels very muted, but you're able to feel it. You can definitely tell it's not of this galaxy.
Okay.
We're going to land on that damn thing.
We can get any sort of like telemetric data and pass that to the fleet and just let them know. Point of interest, no idea what it is.
Unfortunately, you just kind of feel it coming from the planet itself. It's not even okay. Yeah.
Well, we'll still pass along. Like there's something, whatever that thing we might be seeing might be down on the planet. So if we're going to take it out, that's probably where we have to meet that, go through that gauntlet.
I have no idea about anything about the Vong, but I got a sinking suspicion that that planet might be alive.
I hadn't considered that, and I do know a lot about them. That's actually aww, not a bad idea. One way to test it, Caesar.
Intimidation check.
Throw out the asteroid. See who flinches. You were the planet.
I'd like to try to intimidate a planetary body.
Oh, my colonize time you, I has swear come. To
God. I'll colonize you, take all your resources, and just leave you there dead in the middle of space.
Pour in some water, melt some polar caps. Yeah.
Build a factory right on the river, just dump all of it in the water.
So you
just
see what we did to Coruscant. We can the same
do the same to you. Total ownage.
There'll be one little square of mountain left.
Yeah.
And we won't even let you touch it without calling the cops. Well, okay. So pass that along to the fleet just so they're aware of it. I mean, if we can triangulate a position, maybe they can all the Mass Effect 3.
That looks like, if you remember. Looks like we're fighting our way to whatever the hell Uli's feeling out there.
Yeah, I don't think they're going to let us in nicely. This is going to end. This is going to get ugly.
Well, for now, let us focus on making sure our fleet is secure.
Sweet. So you guys see starfighters and gunboats kind of coming in from all directions. You do see there's kind of a couple areas you guys can engage and help protect the fleet as they kind of get their own defensive positions and parameters up. You do see that Kalu and General, or not General Vett, Master Admiral Vexen did bring some of those asteroids and have created their own little asteroid field kind of between themselves and the approaching Yuuzhan Vong fleet. If you guys wanted to have some high-flying asteroid dodging fun with explosive asteroids, you guys can fight some of the cruisers and ships coming through that angle. Or you could take a little bit more of a safer angle, kind of some of the ones that are skirting around as you're laying down a screening force for the Republic ships.
I think that second option sounds better.
It's your ship, Dr. Dichi.
Yeah. I mean, it sounds safer.
Well, not because it's safer, but it seems that they're fine enough on their own with the rock shield over there. Let's take out the stragglers.
All right, maybe we can
secure the flanks,
and then maybe we can find our way down the planet side. All right, let's see what they got.
Perfect. Well, you guys launch the Novacana into the fray. You see as you leave the grouping of the Republic fleet, fighters are launching. They're starting to kind of array themselves defensively against the other fleet, trying to get everything kind of in motion against this invader presence. As you all make your way there, you notice the two gunboats and some accompanying coral skippers take notice of you and begin to track you into the field. Let me throw you on the map. You guys will be coming from the down portion of this area.
Oh, dang. Is that one of the ships?
Oh, yeah, so they, you see they've got two of their gunboats, and all of these are kind of see like a ray of colors coming from their fleets as they kind of all have their own intricate York coral-grown designs. You see the two bigger ships on that side, some of the ones you come across when you were initially escaping Vela, kind of bristling with armaments as well as plasma launchers. Let me get the... There we go. All right, roll initiative for the ships.
Do we do the tactical initiative? Everybody rolls and then average, or how do we do this again?
Your choice, everybody roll an average or just using the Novacanas.
Let's go average.
So we all roll and then take an average. Okay.
18.
We don't have a token to highlight, so we're all going to be in chat, Tegan.
I think I clicked it. Did it not?
Oh, well, because your guy's not on there, so it won't show up for you.
Oh, duh.
Hey, doing my part for the average.
How? Do I have to just throw him out, or what?
Well, oh, no, you're good. It's rolled in there.
No, I tried. It's not doing it. I don't... Try it again.
No, don't, if it rolled, you're good.
It didn't. As far as I could tell. Now it did.
Alright, I think I did something wrong.
Oh, yeah, order of operations. The add it and then divide it.
That'd be really cool.
We're gonna add and then divide after.
Oh, let me see. So,
13.25. Sweet. Yep, parentheses. There you go.
I swear when I was a kid, I was good at math.
It's what if you don't use it every day, it just gets like. And I could imagine, like, even going back to like pre-calc or anything like that, like I would just fail nowadays. Like, I've not thought about any of that since 15 years ago.
It's like, oh, I need to know the percentage to tip. All right, great. Thank you, high school math.
Nowadays, just put on the receipt for you half the time, too. You all see this evading fleet ahead of you, flying in sync, flying in coordination. You see them approaching. The gunboat is the first to act. You see just a raid with just blistering style coral with a silvery hue to its armor. And it is going to launch out. And it's going to start it off with a bang. So it's going to use one of its actions. Try to overload your shields. I don't know why that doesn't say DC 10, but give me a DC 10 Constitution saving throw.
I don't think I've ever seen it say DC 0 before.
Solid. Just enough. So you feel your ship, the Nova, kind of rock and shake. You see the shields kind of start to stress. But luckily, you guys are able to flex the shields and the gravitational field around the Nova Kana to prevent your shields being stripped by the Yuuzhan Vong gunboat. You see as that comes through, its guns blister open and is going to take a shot with its plasma cannons. Did it add that? I don't think it did. Oh, what does it matter there? I'm gonna make sure I click that on. But yeah, so you see it blast out with its plasma cannons. You see it just rays of plasma streak to the sky and back against the sheet.
Uncanny dodge that.
Dodge it.
Or what's it called? Yeah, uncanny dodge.
So that brings it down to 9 plasma damage to the Nova Kana shields. It's gonna hold position there.
I'm also going to reaction angle deflector shield to reduce that damage as well.
Alright.
We are down one power die, so down from 4 power dice to 3 power dice with that.
Perfect. It is the ship starting too.
So we making our way in.
Well, I think we got some people in our ways. What to do here? What is our move speed again?
And Tegan, what was the total damage? Oh, never mind. You already minused it. It was a 1.
Yeah. I can up our move speed. So let me try doing that first.
Oh, hold on. Is that an action? I want you to shoot if it's. We need to be shooting these things.
All right. Wait.
Okay. So. Being the mechanic, can I just shoot the guns?
Oh yeah, if you want to be shooting, you can shoot.
The hell with this. Vars throws his tools on the ground. Alright.
I threw it in chat since you are on the guns, but you can choose to have advantage on your attack. You have to say it before though.
Okay. Reaction, help action, but for the whole crew!
What?
Alright, okay, just...
See, I can move the ship forward if we need it.
Alright, what's our range?
I do not know.
800.
So that would be 40 or 40 feet on the normal board.
That's 500.
Yeah, just add 10 too.
So right, okay, so we'd have to move up. Okay.
Just no, it's on. It's 50 feet per square.
Yeah. Yeah. So 100, 150. I want to be in range.
All right. So, even though I'm in the gunner seat, can I do actions that are relevant to the mechanic?
Yeah, I was in the gunner seat. You could probably like boost weapons and all that stuff. We probably wouldn't be like do the shield stuff.
Yeah, because the shields. The shield is a. I think it's a bonus action too. So, all right, but I do have weapon overload. So, it's that guy.
Sweet.
I don't know why I did that. I was rolling, but we have full power dice at the beginning since it was the new turn.
So, remember correctly, so that's an extra 5. All right, cool. So yeah, I'm gonna pop a shot off at the ship that shot at us.
All right.
I mean, we're in range for that, right? Yeah. Okay. So let's go.
Caesar will give the direct action to let this have advantage.
Okay. I've yet to fire weapons on this ship, so I don't know. Is it DLC 1?
I think they're the same, aren't they?
Well, Jarvis is a plus. Okay, so.
Yep, DLC 1 is you.
All right.
You have advantage. Hey,
I do. Hey. Does that connect?
Oh, yeah, definitely. So you're able to connect with the ship. Just a second, though. Yep, yeah, the blast is able to get through.
All right. And throw 5 on top of that 7, making it 12.
Nice. Now you've blasted the York Coral gunship, and you start to see chunks of rock broken off and vented into space.
All right, well, there we go. Anybody else? Is Jarvis going to pop a shot off, or?
Yeah, Jarvis is going to focus on the smaller fighters so that we're not getting pelted while we try to take on these other larger ships. I'm going to shoot this guy over here to the right.
Uh-huh.
Jarvis, don't film me now. I swear to God.
Boom. That'll hit. All right, yeah, that goes through. You blasted the ship. You see it is burning. The chunk of it comes flying off. It definitely looks like it is on its last legs.
We can fire the turrets once each a turn, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. So then the only thing we'd have left is the... Is it tertiary or quaternary?
Tertiary. I don't think he has any
secondary.
Bombs.
Yeah. Okay. Say we could fire one of those off, or I'm just going to take the evade action because that seemed to work so well last time.
We kind of need it in this. This case being outnumbered the way we are.
Now, I have an ability here. I'm a little confused on what it means. Maybe you can clarify for me, Tegan. Where is this?
And I will say we forgot to do this last time we did evade. But if you do take the evade action, it affects your entire ship. But any ability check or attack made by your ship has disadvantage at the end of your ship's next turn.
Oh, we can cover that.
You just assist that. Someone and give them
help. Yeah. I suppose it's worth it.
I mean, do you want to take a bunch of damage? That's my thinking.
Absolutely not. Which is exactly
he's not even
why.
Thinking he's flying.
Which is exactly why I'm going to. This is the wrong sheet. Novacana. Here we go. Boost shields. And I think I got this set up. It's a DC 10. This should give us... Oh, I rolled max. So I need to do DC 10 strength.
Nice.
Cool. 8 temporary shield points.
And Tegan, I'll try spinning in there. That's the ability. I guess I'm just confused. Because you already have disadvantage on that stuff. Is it attacks too? Is that what that is?
Let me read that real quick.
I think evade is just saves.
Oh my god, there's so much to track.
Attacks. Yeah, there is. This is ridiculous. Yeah, I'm just trying to see how that's any different from the actual evade action, because it seems like evade lets you do it from all of them. This one's just making it one.
Yeah, that one's weird. Let me look it up in the system to make sure
that it makes it like, to it. I was just wondering if that's more like you can do it against one ship and it doesn't have the disadvantage for the ship, but it's the downside is it's only one ship in particular.
That's my guess, to be honest. That's what we'll do.
Once or less. Okay. So I'm not going to use ship that.
And then just basically you don't have to worry about the disadvantage piece from it.
Okay. I'm not going to use that right now, but I was just trying to clarify in case we did want to use it. I'll just do normal evade.
Perfect. Anything else anybody can do for this one?
No.
Alright.
Because you can't use... You need a feature or something to use something like a superiority dice on the ship, right? Same way you gotta have a feature to like force cast on the ship or tech cast.
Yeah, so exactly. So you'd have something, so like, I'm not sure what ventures that Caesar has from his coordinator stuff, but a lot of those let you use the kind of comms dice to boost damage or something like that.
Let me double check that, but yeah, I don't got anything.
Alright. We see the coral skippers kind of begin just jutting into the battle with leading with the one that was damaged earlier. You see he is got his ship bristling with plasma cans he spits out. He's gonna do that. That'd be fun. So you see, like, he turns towards you guys, ship barely holding itself together, venting atmosphere off into the abyss. And he ramps his speed up and shows no signs of letting it go. He is gonna try to ram you guys. So let's see how that works again. Let's see. So we take the ram action, you're going to make a strength check opposed by the target's maneuvering check. On a failed check, the ramming fails. On a success, both you and the ship take kinetic damage equal to two of the initial ship's HD die plus its strength modifier. So let's see. So you see this guy just going in. Just definitely no cause for his own safety. Did it add it in? It did. Oof. All right, got to beat a 24.
Okay.
Jarvis is going to...
Guidance?
Jarvis is going to use versatile transport. I don't think it takes an action or anything to do that. You can just do it 6 times. So I'm going to burn one of those. So he's going to do this at advantage.
What's versatile transport again?
Oh.
I will link it. There it is.
I think I might have something to save us here.
Nice.
This is not a saving throw. Would Watch Out help with this? Or no?
Well, if we meet it, we beat it, right? Isn't that how that works?
Yeah, if you meet it, you beat it. So he has... You're good.
Oh, yeah.
I have something that can put us over the edge anyway, so...
I thought that was a 25 for a second, and now it's just a 24.
Yeah, so you see the ship kind of running through, look like it's willing to sacrifice itself to damage the Nova Kana, but fortunately you guys are able to maneuver out of the way as you see the ship just kind of stalled and speaks ahead of you. All right, let's get these other guys going. You see this one flies in, just guns bristling. It is going to shoot at you with its plasma cannon. For the 5 energy damage to the ship.
Reaction feedback shield.
Nice. Is that a dexterity save or does it just come right through?
As far as I know, it just takes one of our power die. And then it just reflects it back. Oh, we also take that damage, I believe, too.
Yeah, you definitely take the damage from this one.
Yeah. But they take that damage.
Perfect.
Evade. Disadvantage.
Oh, yeah, it would be a disadvantage.
Right. Okay, maybe we won't be spending a reaction.
Technically would be for the dude, too, but we already passed that one. Or does that not count?
Oh. Oh, no.
Tegan is a high roller.
And so this guy is hot at the sticks, but definitely you see as he shoots that bolts of plasma and you see it arc against your shield, you see a line of electricity arc out and just blast into the coral of the ship, damaging him slightly. Or actually damaging him a good bit. He's definitely burnt up. You start to see his ship coming apart around him. Last two guys. This guy's gonna, seeing the shields arc out for his buddy, he's going to try to pull down your shields. Give me a constitution saving throw.
Which guy?
This one over here.
Okay. What is the DC, does it say?
Oh, shouldn't 10. Be an advantage, but it's 11.
So, you're good. Sweet, and the last guy is going to take a shot at you with his plasma cannon. With disadvantage. Sweet, and you see him launch that cannon and just hit space as the bolt streaks behind you. I've got the last gun bolt. It is going to maneuver a little bit closer to the crew. And you see its plasma cannons open up. And it is going to plasma barrage you. So make a DC 13 dexterity saving throw. Solid. You guys would have had an advantage on that one, but luckily you're able to succeed. So you guys just take 12 damage to your shield.
All uncanny dodge that to cut it down to what, 6?
Perfect.
Yeah.
It is going to shoot you one last time with his cannon. You'd have disadvantage there anyway, but he misses. So you see the sky just alight with plasma as the Yuuzhan Vong are trying to gun you down, but the Nova Kana is holding out pretty sturdily so far. Oh, yeah, you guys are in a weird place with us. Now the other guy gets to go. All right. He is going to... he's going to try to tractor beam you. So you see... See the nimble Nova Kana dodging around some of their blows. You see, feel kind of a gravitic hold kind of encase the ship and start pulling you backwards. Strength saving throw, nice, and you guys knock it out. So you feel in there and were luckily able to hit the engines just the right time and break their hold on you. They're just going to hit you another plasma barrage, so give me another dexterity saving throw with advantage due to evade. So you guys take 12 energy damage to your shields, and you are up.
I'm uncanny dodging that for my second reaction.
And can I use my reaction, since I use Jarvis's reaction for feedback shield, can I use my reaction for angle deflector to reduce?
Yeah, sure. If you guys have the actions I don't think there's anything.
So that's going to take a power die as well to reduce that damage. So that's reduced to 5 and then halved, so only 2. Or 3, I mean.
Solid.
We just don't get hurt.
Okay. Beginning of the turn, we automatically regen 6. So we're back up to 120 shield. I'm going to action boost shield. Damn, only 4 temp hit points.
Strength save at disadvantage.
At disadvantage. Okay.
Nice. 14.
So we get 4 temp hit points or shield points. And then Jarvis is going to shoot at the guy nearest to us.
I need that disadvantage. But
oh, disadvantage. Yep.
All right. He's just going to main action assist bars and shooting.
All right. So I think I'll also take a shot at the one right next to us. Try to bring down that action economy of theirs.
All
right. And let's hope it does it.
Yeah, well, with Caesar's assistance there, you're able to tag that ship.
All right.
Nice, take him down.
All right. Pew, 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 pew. A rain of coral and fire explodes in space. Nice. One less for us to deal with. Uli, do you want to move somewhere else, or...
Sorry, I was muted. I mean, it looks like they're just going to drag us around the battlefield anyway. Might as well sit tight and, you know, spin, spin, spin. Keep them off of us. All right. Some tight maneuvering.
Okay. In that case, would I be able to use my bonus action to roll for shield reinforcement?
Sure.
All right, so it's just rolling the... That's what it is, and it's currently a d6, still a d6, so we get 5 points of shield back. Oh, that's enough. All right, we're back to 1. Hey, back to full for now.
Are they capable of shooting through each other? Token-wise, or would they have to reposition?
Oh yeah, they are with 3D space.
Yeah. So, I am trying to think the actual advantage of moving around versus sitting still with this kind of combat system.
Well, if we didn't have guns that could move, then yeah, we definitely want to be moving around a hell of a lot more.
That is fair.
All right.
The Nova Kana is so sleek and stealthy that bullets just...
Just slide off.
I blend in with the face.
Throwing molten rocks at us. We kind of need to dodge.
Oh yeah, that's all I got in this.
I'm thinking just another evade. I feel like a fool. I could have used my target acquired and spent a bonus, or use a bonus action to expend a power die and give advantage on an attack roll, and if it hits, add that the D6 to the damage. So
there's so much to remember in space, man.
I know.
I feel like I have to do a campaign where it's only space combat. Only just, space combat to actually learn it. I have 2 sheets up at the same time right now. I'm looking at the Nova Kana and mine over here because I'm forgetting about things that I can do too. So
it's a tabletop RPG within a tabletop RPG.
Nah, there's so much. So
we're passing then.
Alright. So you see this coral skippers going in. You see them first one, he's gonna target your shields. So you feel a pull against your shield generator.
The guy that's currently in queue right now, Tegan, he's dead.
Oh yeah, they all go at the same time.
Oh, sorry. I'm a baddie.
Yeah, with you guys in a weird placement, so you're ahead of one of the your coral guys, but they're all kind of like tagged in right at the same point, pretty much. So they all kind of go in a row. So give me a DC 10 Constitution save. Solid. So you see the little shields pulling against you, but luckily you're able to keep them grounded with the ship. You see another one is rolling in closer to you. It's going to open up with its plasma cannon. Oh, disadvantage. That will hit.
Okay, so as a reaction, I am going to... I'm going to do two things, actually. Talus is going to intensify shields. This is going to burn a power die, and it's going to increase our AC by the same amount. I don't know why I don't have this on the Novacana sheet. I'll link it right there. So power die increase. Wow. Our AC is currently 24 now.
Nice.
And then Jarvis is going to feedback shield as well to give them back two damage.
So wait, did that hit?
Wait, so if it doesn't hit, does it work?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you'd better do both of those.
Do I need to do both of those then? If I increase the AC, reading it.
It says includes a triggering attack, so it would miss.
Okay. Disregard Jarvis then, I guess. I'll just minus one power die.
So if anybody... that lasts until our turn? Or just the round? Or the...
Yeah, it's our next turn.
Oh, okay.
That's kind of insane.
That is insane. 297,000 credits or whatever the hell that was.
I mean, come on. These guys are rolling high. They're rolling like 24s and stuff, so.
So save that other reaction for whenever somebody does hit us.
Yeah. I mean, Jarvis has a reaction that he can use. He can use modification reactions. That's the best thing about, if you scroll down, I have it open right now. It's the Mark II. Mark III, he's able to fly the ship and do pilot stuff now too. So.
All right, well, the last guy, seeing you all, he is in range. He is going to try to ram you as well. So you see this guy just maneuvering in, trying to smash into your ship. So give me a maneuvering check for the Novacana.
I'm going to use versatile transport on this one too to give advantage to the ship.
Alright.
I don't know why it didn't give me advantage. Oh, because I didn't turn it on. But I don't think it matters. So.
It does, so you need to reroll on that one because it's 21 versus 20.
Oh. No!
hold on, reaction. Hold on. I got something. So, our power die is a what, a D8?
Fortunately, it's not a saving throw.
Yeah, it's all the way down.
It's not? Oh. It's an attack, right?
Or ability check.
Okay.
Does anyone have anything that can add a plus one?
I don't think Defiant would work in ship combat.
Unfortunately, not for that one.
Yep.
No plus ones on this one?
But my AC is 24. I'm just kidding.
If we're lucky, it might just blow itself up.
Actually, highly possible here.
Well, thank you for giving the DM ideas.
So let's see. Where is it not rolling damage?
It does damage to itself, right?
So. It does. So it takes a success. Both of you guys take equal damage. Connect damage equal to your ship's HD and strength modifier. If your ship has shield points remaining, you take half damage instead. So you guys will take half of this 13. This guy takes it right to his hull.
Is that straight hull damage, not shield?
I think they're going to go straight to your hull, but it's half due to you having a shield still.
Can you dodge that? What's our hull points?
I mean, if we're only taking half, if that goes down to 6, we're only taking 3 points. We're down to 48 out of 51 hull points.
Think it's worth it?
Those big ships have
been saved for the bigger one. All right, yeah. I'll save it for the bigger
one. Yeah, if they manage to pull down our shields and get a nice plasma bolt in.
Yeah,
100%.
Okay. All right, hold on.
What's the chances of us failing that constitution save?
enough that it makes you concerned.
We're burning all the high rolling. So
perfect. Well, the gunboat is up and it is going to strip shield. So give me a constitution saving throw. It is also going to launch a plasma cannon attack at you with disadvantage. Sweet, so you are able to keep your shields up, but that cannon attack will hit.
AC is 24, sir.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that. Fortunately, you are able to evade that and keep up your damage there.
Thank you, Talus, for upgrading the ship.
All it took was giving the Republic some data, right?
We're sending all this as, like, you know, play by play to the Admiral. Like, hey, we got your flank over here, guys.
Yeah. All right.
The chances to fail the Constitution save is 1 in 4.
You see that ability I've got? I can add an extra D8 to whatever it is if we fail to try to make it pass.
Yeah, there's that, and we have 4 versatile transport left to give us advantage on the roll, too, so.
Would I fly this ship not confident in my ability to get it safely onto the ground?
No. Probably not.
I am not just a leaf on the wind. I'm an entire plant gliding in the wind.
Gliding on the wind.
I don't know why, but the only thing I...
For that plant.
I can only imagine, like, in a storm, like a tree in a tornado. Woo!
Guys, sorry, I'm rolling too good. It's about to die. Like,
what was that, Tegan?
Dexterity save.
Oh, dexterity save. Yeah. Oh, now we're screwed. Okay.
Still covers that dex save.
Sweet. So I guess we'll take half damage here. It actually is going to hit you again with that. So we make another dexterity
throw. I'm going to use my reaction to have... the halved one again.
Alright.
Okay, so down to 14 and then halved to 7.
Yep.
Okay, so that's minus 4 from the shield and then another 3 down to 20. 120. Okay, cool. And then another deck save. Cool. 19. So taking half, that'll be 11.
Nice.
Okay. Which will put us down to 109. Cool.
Alright, and the Novacana is up.
Alright, Novacana will gain 6 shield back. We're back up to 115 out of 123. Power die regen, we get 2. We're back up to a maximum of 4. I'm going to...
Are you attacking with Jarvis?
Yeah, I'm going to do that after I do Talus stuff.
I can use the bonus action thing to give him advantage, so it just negates the disadvantage, if you want.
Okay. Cool.
It expends a power die. But
okay.
Here.
I'm gonna boost shield as well as an action, so that'll give us full that I can get on that, as long as I roll above a 10 or a 10. Yes.
Oh, with a disadvantage, 8. Unfortunately.
Even the boost, it gives us disadvantage on everything?
It does.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Well, luckily it doesn't matter.
Okay, so that's minus one power die, I believe. No, boosting doesn't minus power die. That's the regen that minuses it. And then Jarvis is going to take his attack at normal, not advantage, right?
So I have to pick a single target to put that on. So whoever Jarvis is attacking, I'm assuming Jarvis is talking to me. You would just tell me which one he wants and I'll...
Yeah, he's going to target the one right in front.
Okay.
21. Roll damage, 8.
Nice, take him down.
And then there was something else that I wanted to do. Jarvis. Jarvis can do... Nope, he can't because he just uses action. Okay, cool. We don't have any bonus action features that from our modifications. Okay, yeah, that's it.
All right. Well, I guess I'll take a shot at one of the...
Main action, direct action. In addition, uplifting directive. I almost forgot I had that. So at some point, I can give us a natural one.
Thank you. Good to know. All right, so first thing I'll do is weapon overload. So I'll roll my tech die. It'll give us 3 points the next time a ship deals damage for the end of the next turn. And I'll take a shot at this one here.
Perfect.
Doesn't matter.
Unfortunately, the blaster bolt scorches through the sky.
All right. And
Tegan, as a bonus action, Jarvis will actually reload his laser cannon.
Nice.
That he's controlling.
Oh, I guess I'll do that next turn.
Don't worry about it. Jarvis can do it for you.
Oh, well, that's nice of Jarvis. All right. Well, that's all I got. Anybody else?
All right. That's the crew. We'll get one more round.
I was reading. We could do evade again. Or can I make an attack run and use the quaternary or whatever our missile?
Yeah, you can use missiles. Yeah.
Should we do that? Send one at the cruiser, or
I was thinking to save those for the larger ones, but up to you. Those are expensive missiles. It's
worth the larger.
$1,500 a missile.
That's right. All right.
I'm a bit hesitant because this may not be the only ship combat we face.
Yeah, well, there's a whole fleet of them out there, so
yeah, I'm scared because these are the baby
evade ones. Again.
These are the baby ones. I'm waiting for Tegan to throw us one that Uli's takes up
just
an entire corner.
Just spinning whatever passes for a wheel. Just spin it.
I'm looking forward to us trying to face down an entire battleship.
I'm not.
Yeah, I'm not. Well,
no.
Got to roll a new character at some point, I guess.
Alright. So that's the crew's turn. Let's get a couple of these guys going. This guy's going to launch a stream of plasma at the ship. Disadvantage. That will miss. As you see, kind of tried to pick a bead on you guys with Uli at the sticks. He's having trouble getting a lock. The other is going to... he's going to attempt to overload your shields. Let's give me a... I don't know why I go weird there. DC 10 Constitution saving throw. Solid. You feel it pulling against your shields, but you guys are able to pull out and keep everything floating. And then it's just the big guys pounding into their shields again. Sweet. So let's get some plasma cannons going. The first guy is just going to take two shots with his cannons. Oh, so the first one will miss.
The 18 hits.
Oh, well, he has disadvantage due to the evade.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
Second one will miss as well. So it's his turn. The other guy is just going to barrage you all with plasma. So give me two dexterity saving throws.
Hey.
Nice. So you guys see just raining plasma in the area, just lighting up the space around you all with bolts. But luckily, the crew is able to fly through, just taking half damage from these barrages.
I want to uncanny dodge one of those, but it'd be fair to say that I wouldn't have known the second one would do so much damage and just do it on the first.
Yeah, sure.
All right.
Yeah, I'm going to... Shit, there's a reaction I can take. I'm looking at the wrong sheet.
The feedback?
No. Angle deflector on the first one as well. It's something. So yeah, reduced by 3. So what would that come to? So that's 13.
So 26 down to 13 because we made the save. And then half of 13 is 6 because of uncanny dodge. And then it would be the minus 3, so 3. That makes sense.
Perfect.
We succeed on the second one.
Okay. Did you minus that already from us?
I didn't touch anything.
Oh, I forgot to add 10 hit points. Okay, cool. We're down to 5 10 hit points. There we go. Cool. Or 4. No, that's right. Was it minus 4 or minus 3 on the damage?
For the first one, I think it was minus 4.
Okay. Yep, okay. Got it. And then a full 33 on the second one.
18.
Ooh.
18. F. Okay. Oh, sorry, 16. The Novacana is just built indestructible.
don't say that.
Don't say that. Okay, so that was my reaction to reduce the damage. So we still have a reaction left by Jarvis. Okay, cool.
Just picture you. I am invincible.
No.
Yeah. You're just begging
shut
to get
up, Ross. You're just begging to get a bunch of liquid nitrogen blown up on you.
Perfect. Well, you guys see the battle raging on behind you, and you see kind of reports of your sensors. You see the Republic ships start to take casualties as the Yuuzhan Vong swarm around them. You see them trying to pull back, kind of maneuver there. You see Admiral Vexen, you know, all ships report that they're trying to pull the Republic ships behind the gas giant, using it as cover and kind of a spot for them to reform and stage kind of a push back against the Vong. You see they put a call out for assistance. That's actually where we'll wrap up today. With that, as you all see the Republic fleet getting bombarded, ships going down, we'll pick up the next session with kind of how that will all play out. So join us directly next Tuesday. I think that's May now. We'll kick off the next part of the adventure. Definitely make sure to come through tomorrow or Thursday. I'm having a couple days this week for the Call of Cthulhu game. Looking forward to that one. The chance to win a free PDF copy. So come through there. Make sure to join us next Tuesday to see how this one plays out with more to come from the Invaders. So we'll see you all next week.
Bye.